Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to your National World War I Museum and Memorial. My name is Laura Vogt. I'm the Curator of Education, and it is my pleasure to welcome you here on a day that feels a little bit fit for Tolkien, with this kind of wind and gray, and a fit for International Tolkien Reading Day. And we are so pleased to have another round of our Talking Tolkien events. If you have not joined us previously, we do hope that every March you take a look and you sign up for our newsletter and see what events are going on. For example, right now we do have an amazing exhibition taking place in the new Wiley Gallery. We have on display John Singer Sargent Gast, which actually includes John Singer Sargent's Gast. It is 9 feet, it is over 9 feet high, 21 feet long. It is monumental. And the first time that it has been displayed here in the Midwest, and potentially the last time, it's only the second time it's been in the United States. And in that exhibition, we look at not only John Singer Sargent's experiences on the front, but that continuing story, the enduring impact of protection and detection of chemical weapons. Now, this brilliant oil painting is actually on loan to us from the Imperial War Museums, and it is the Imperial War Museums that also happen to have the firearm of J.R.R. Tolkien. And if you talk about the enduring impact of war, Tolkien and his writings is an incredible place to start. Now, here at the National World War I Museum and Memorial, we've been collecting since 1920. We actually opened this incredible space that you see on the exterior in 1926. That would be 1 year after Tolkien published Sir Gawain and the Green Knight, the version that he had edited. And there are so many more connections that we are going to look at and explore today. And it's my pleasure to be welcoming Robbie Park of Park University and the president of the Tolkien Society here in Kansas City. Now, I know that there are going to be some really great questions out of the stories and the events that she talks about. If you notice on either side, there are some stairs that lead down, and that's going to be a great place for the Q&A. And since we're recording today, we'd really love to be sure that you come down and you bring your questions. You will see Camille, who will help moderate that Q&A as well. Now might also be a great time. Some of you may use this to listen to audiobooks of Tolkien or to read. Now's a great time to turn that to silent as well. Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, would you please join me in welcoming Robbie Parker. So Robbie Park.
Good afternoon. Thank you all so much for joining me. And I want to wish you all, first of all, a happy International Tolkien Reading Day. Yay! All right. And today's lecture, of course, is going to be about World War I. And this lecture is going to be broken apart into three sort of pieces. And in the first part, what we're going to do is we're going to talk about Tolkien and his life right around World War I. So I'm not going to be talking about any of his early life. So he did start writing at an early age, but we're not going to talk about that today. We're really going to start the story in 1914. But before we do that, I want to start off first with a quote. An author cannot, of course, remain wholly unaffected by his experience, but the ways in which a story germ uses the soil of experience are extremely complex, and attempts to define the process are at best guesses from evidence that is inadequate and ambiguous. It is also false, though naturally attractive, when the lives of an author and critic have overlapped, to suppose that the movements of thought or the events of times common to both were necessarily the most powerful influences. One has indeed personally to come under the shadow of war to feel fully its oppression. But as the years go by, it seems now often forgotten that to be caught in youth by 1914 was no less hideous an experience than to be involved in 1939 and the following years. By 1918, all but one of my close friends were dead. This is taken from the foreword to the second edition of The Lord of the Rings. And if you own The Lord of the Rings, in fact, you probably have a reprint of the second edition, which includes this foreword. If you have never taken the time to read the foreword, I highly suggest that you do so, because it does have some very interesting personal reflections on wartime experience such as this. Additionally, one other thing I'd like to add is that Tolkien really did not support the idea that, for him, writing was allegorical. What he believed was that writing was contextual. And so today what we're really talking about is the context in which Tolkien wrote his works. And that is really, of course, the background is World War I. So starting off with that, we're going to talk first about Tolkien's experiences and the world in 1914. If you would like to know more about the lead-up to World War I and what caused World War I, there is, in fact, a fantastic museum right behind you that you can go visit. That being said, of course, England is going to enter World War I because of Germany, which I'm sure I don't need to point that out on the map. Germany is going to violate Belgian neutrality, and that's going to lead England to declare war on Germany. And so at that point in 1914, England will enter the war. Now, at the same time, what was happening in England for Tolkien? At that time, now Tolkien was born in 1892, which makes him about 22 years old when World War I breaks out. Tolkien was attending Oxford University, where he planned to and would get a degree in English language and literature. And he had an interesting little group of friends, and this group was actually quite large. I want to point out here that there were about 20 men in this group, but there were really four primary gentlemen in this group that made up the most of the group. And this is the Tea Club and Barovian Society, of which there were four members: Christopher Wiseman, Geoffrey Bock-Smith, of course, John Ronald Tolkien, which everybody called him Ronald, and then Robert Quilter Gilson, otherwise known as R.Q. Gilson, and then Geoffrey Bock-Smith usually went by G.B. Smith. Now, this was called the Tea Club and Barovian Society. Why? Well, because these four men, being the naughty youngsters that they were at the age of 21, 22 years old, would illicitly drink tea in the library, which was strictly banned. They would stay up late at night and drink tea, and then they would translate sagas and then read them out loud to each other, and would also write and share original poems, original stories, things like that. And so that was the tea club part of the title. And then Barovian Society came from the fact that they would meet at a place called Barrow's Department Store. And these four men were basically inseparable. They also played rugby together. They were at Oxford together. So try to imagine in 1914, okay, so just to go back to the previous slide, that all of these things are happening in the great outside world. And here you are, and you've got your little secret society, which they called the TCBS, and they referred to it that way in letters, much of which I'm going to refer to Tolkien's letters today in the lecture, that they had this little group. They did a lot of private writing and translation, and they shared this very closely between these four men, like I said, in particular, who were the central members. And they were tight-knit. Imagine being 22 years old. Imagine, go back, for those of you who are older than that, go back to the time when you were 22 and think about how you felt, that you had your close friends at the time, that you were inseparable, and that you were invincible. And that's important to think about as we're about to head into World War I. Now, at the time, Tolkien had only done a little bit of writing. Well, not a little bit of writing, but had only been published a very little bit, and he published one poem called Goblin Feet. I'm not going to read this out loud to you right now, but you can actually read it for free online. It was published in Oxford Poetry in 1915. And so in between 1914 and 1915, of course, the world on the outside of Oxford, is changing. And so, unfortunately, all four of these men are going to sign up to go to war. And on the left over here is G.B. Smith, and then this is Tolkien right here, and then Christopher Wiseman, who's going to sign up in the Navy, and then R.Q. Gilson here on farthest to the right. So the three men are going to sign up in the Army, and then just Christopher Wiseman is going to be in the Navy. Now, during this time period, More and more men are enlisting. Now, the four men, G.B. Smith and then R.Q. Gilson right here, have both enlisted and have left Oxford. So now it's just Tolkien and Wiseman, who are a little bit younger. And Tolkien desperately wants to finish his degree. He really wants to get it done. But eventually, in 1915, things are starting to look more grim at Oxford. Tolkien is one of only 24 men left at Oxford. It's not a lot. And as you might imagine, the social implications of not enlisting are becoming more and more oppressive. So, of course, Tolkien is going to take a first-class honors in his degree, and then as soon as he's finished and graduates with his degree, he immediately enlists. Christopher Wiseman also enlists, and so all four men will now be enlisted. Now, Tolkien decides that he's going to sign up with actually a particular kind of battalion, the Salford Battalion. It was the 3rd Salford Pals, which is part of the 11th Lancashire Fusiliers, and this is in the army. Tolkien signs up with the Pals. Now, I don't know if you're familiar with the Pals, but the Pals were actually very specific kinds of battalions that were designed by the military to sort of pull from local areas. So whenever you signed up with the Pals in your area, it was actually sort of implied that you'd be signing up with other members of your community. So you could sign up with your cousin, you could sign up with the guy living down the street from you, but the idea is that whenever you deployed, you were actually with other people that you knew. And that the idea was to increase the camaraderie and things like that. So Tolkien's going to sign up with the 3rd Salford Pals. He is also going to get engaged to his longtime girlfriend, Edith Bratt. And even his brother is also going to sign up. Hillary will sign up and become a bugler in the army. And right before he leaves in 1916, which is when he's going to deploy, he also marries his fiance. He marries Edith Bratt. And it is when he marries her that he is about to leave for France that all of a sudden he feels death. He feels that he is dying in leaving Edith behind, because at this point in 1916, very bad news has started to come back from the front, of course, by now. When the war broke out in 1914, a lot of people said, sure, of course you all enlist, I'll go to war, it'll be a great story to tell, I'll be back by Christmas. That, of course, will not happen. So Tolkien leaves, and he deploys for France, and ends up in the trenches. And this is a very famous quote. In fact, it's used to describe war so frequently, I actually could not trace the source of this quote. Months of boredom punctuated by moments of terror. And this is often how people tend to describe wartime experience. Tolkien is going to deploy to France with the 3rd Salford Pals. And at this point, all four members of the TCBS have deployed to different parts. Three of them are in France. The three men in the army are all in France. So that's G.B. Smith, R.Q. Gilson, and J.R.R. Tolkien are in France somewhere. They don't know where each other is. And of course, as you might guess, letters are being checked over. People are going through to make sure that no information is being leaked out because they don't want anything to fall into enemy hands. And so on July 1st, one of the most significant battles of World War I is going to take place, and that is the Somme. And one thing I want to draw your attention to while I have this slide up here is how long this battle is. July 1st to November 18th of 1916, that's a long, long time. When we think of battle, we tend, I don't know if this is just because of film and TV, but I think a lot of times we assume battles take place in hours, maybe a few days, something like that. This took place over months. And the whole time, just to go back to this slide very quickly, Tolkien is stuck in the trenches while the Somme is going on. And what is there to do in the trenches? Not a lot, other than hide and hope that a shell does not get you. As it says up here, months of boredom punctuated by moments of terror. But Tolkien does start to do a lot of letter writing. He's writing a lot of letters, he's also writing stories. And it is on the back of a spare sheet of music paper that he's going to start writing what will become the genesis of The Silmarillion. The Silmarillion is really Tolkien's masterpiece in many ways. It's a shame that more people don't read it. But Tolkien is going to start developing this mythology, and he's going to continue writing. And I showed that slide earlier of the poem Goblin Feet. as he's writing, he's sort of struggling to find a central message, or like, not necessarily a purpose, but he wants to find a grander sense of meaning, and that is something that we're going to talk about closer to the end of this lecture, about what exactly that meaning is, and what that ultimate message really is about. So Tolkien is stuck in the trenches, and he's writing, and he and the three members of the TCBS are writing letters back and forth to each other. Like I said, they don't know where exactly the other person is. And he is crushed to receive the following letter on July 7th. "My dear John Ronald, I saw in the paper this morning that Rob has been killed. I am safe, but what does that matter? Do please stick to me, you and Christopher. I'm very tired and most frightfully depressed at this worst of news. Now one realizes in despair what the TCBS really was. Oh, my dear John Ronald, whatever are we going to do? Yours ever, GBS." And that is Jeffrey Bocksmith. So the first of Tolkien's great friends has unfortunately been killed. And this completely guts Tolkien. It absolutely guts him. He doesn't even know how to respond or what to say about this. All he can really do, stuck in the trenches, what else can he do but keep staying in the trenches day after day and wondering what exactly he can do? And about a week later, he receives another letter from G.B. Smith, from the same person. And again, keep in mind, this is in the Somme. Okay, R.Q. Gilson was killed on the first day of the Somme. He was killed July 1st. "My chief consolation is that if I am scuppered tonight, there will still be left a member of our school group to voice what I dreamed and what we all agreed upon. For the death of one of its members cannot, I am determined, dissolve the group. Death can make us loathsome and helpless as individuals, but it cannot put an end to the immortal four. May God bless you, my dear John Ronald, and may you say things I have tried to say long after I am not there to say them, if such be my lot." It is that night that G.B. Smith is going to go over the top. If you don't know what that means, it means he's going to go out of the trench and go over the top into no man's land, and he will be killed next. So now two of Tolkien's great friends are gone. And again, Tolkien doesn't know what to make of this. Why is he left? Why is he still alive? He goes into the Somme. He is deployed with the C Company of the Salford Pals. He goes into the Somme, into no man's land. He survives over 60 hours of battle. But he comes back. And he doesn't know why this is. And in the process of letter writing back and forth between him and Christopher Wiseman, Wiseman convinces him that there must be a reason. There must be a reason you were left behind. There's a reason why you and I are still alive. Maybe we don't know what that is, but I believe it's connected to your writing. I believe it's connected to that. And Tolkien isn't sure. He's not sure about anything at this point. And luckily or not, you might call this unlucky, but in this case, well, we will go ahead and call it very lucky. Tolkien is going to contract trench fever right after this. And over here to the left is a delousing station. It's a picture here of some soldiers waiting to go into the showers to be deloused. And then over here on the right, we have a soldier picking lice out of his uniform. Ick. And this is how you contract trench fever, if you're not aware. Trench fever is transmitted by lice, which bites you. And then there are a number of symptoms that you will contract. And the difficulty with trench fever is that it's, in fact, cyclical. So it will continue to come back, even if you happen to get rid of it for a little while, it will reappear again, and it can reappear for up to 2 to 3 years after you initially get it. So Tolkien is sent back to a hospital on the coast of France, and then from there, he doesn't really get any better in convalescing, and so he is sent back to England. And in this case, or in this particular regard, the trench fever saved his life, absolutely saved his life. The chances of surviving the Somme were 1 in 3. So almost certainly, if Tolkien had been sent back in again, I don't think he would have made it. So he returns to England on November 8th, and he has to deal with the fact that, why is he left alive? As I've mentioned earlier, why is he left alive? And he doesn't really have a lot else to do in the hospital other than he's writing letters to Wiseman, he's writing letters to his wife to let her know that he's okay. And ultimately, of course, the war is going to end. And so the world goes from looking like this in 1914 to looking like this afterward. So Tolkien comes out of this war a changed man, not just in the sense that he has changed personally, but obviously on even a global scale, the world is very, very different than what he once knew. And in many ways, how can you share the events of World War I with anyone else other than the people you went through it with? And he doesn't really talk about it too much. He talks about it with Christopher Wiseman a little bit, but eventually it becomes so painful for the two of them to talk that they really don't for a long time. And if you get a chance, read the book Tolkien and the Great War by John Garth. He goes into detail about this a little bit more. But for both Christopher Wiseman, who also escaped the war alive, and Tolkien, they both struggled to even communicate with each other because the things that they had shared in losing their friends and the things that they had shared in battle were so difficult for them that they could not really even talk about their grief. And so in a lot of ways, I think it's an outlet, an expressive outlet to include some of the battle scenes, for example, in The Hobbit. The Hobbit, I don't think, really draws too much experience from World War I, but if you read The Battle of Five Armies at the end of The Hobbit, which The Hobbit will be published in 1937, I do think that there are some really grim, really dark parts of The Hobbit in that battle. I'm not going to talk about that here today. I'm going to talk a little bit more about The Lord of the Rings, because I feel like, of course, that's a little more well-known. So, post-war, Tolkien goes back to England, and things carry on almost totally normal. Tolkien is actually a remarkably boring person. He doesn't really do a lot other than be a professor. He becomes a professor at Oxford. He grades exams. He has four children. His eldest son, John Francis, will become a Catholic priest, and then his other two sons are going to partake in something else that's going to happen coming down the pipeline, which of course is World War II. So of course, this is the setup to World War II, and as things are becoming increasingly tense in Europe, Tolkien is going to start writing about some of this in his letters, and that's what I would like to share about you for this next part of the lecture, which is regarding his literary reflections and how he expressed his wartime experiences through literature, but then also his personal reflections on the war, which he expressed through his letters, which I actually think are absolutely fascinating. If you have not read the letters of J.R.R. Tolkien, they are remarkable. So, what I would like to talk about first, to go through some of these literary reflections, is, and these are some images from the Psalm. These are actually from the Psalm. Is I would like to share just some excerpts from The Lord of the Rings, and also from some of his letters. And so, first of all, I want to start off with this letter. It's letter 226 that he wrote in 1960. But he's talking about the landscape. And the landscape is one of the often cited parts of The Lord of the Rings, and also I would even argue of the five great battles of the Silmarillion, the five great battles of Middle-earth, where he used a lot of description that I think could absolutely be applied to the scenery that is in World War I, not just in his literature. And so this is a quote. "Personally, I do not think that either war, and of course not the atomic bomb, had any influence upon either the plot or the manner of its unfolding, perhaps in landscape. The dead marshes and the approaches to the Morannon owe something to northern France after the Battle of the Somme." And this is, of course, this is all northern France right here. And then also I want to share one other quote from The Two Towers. This is from Book 4, Chapter 2, The Passage of the Marshes, which is probably the most famously attributed quote. "Dreadful as the dead marshes had been, and the arid moors of the Noman lands, more loathsome by far was the country that the crawling day now slowly unveiled to his shrinking eyes. Here nothing lived, not even the leprous growths that feed on rottenness. The gasping pools were choked with ash and crawling muds, sickly white and gray, as if the mountains had vomited the filth of their entrails on the lands about." So that's pretty grim, I would say. And here I have this quote here. And again, it's the Psalm, but it is the Dead Marshes, I think, in its own way. Now, Tolkien also, in the books, as has been, I think, heavily because of the films, talked about, Tolkien did not care for machinery. And of course, what do we see in World War I? The first rollout of the tank, right? Although it doesn't work very well. That there is a tank that is used in the war. And then also we have planes, which I love this picture. This gentleman got stuck in a tree, which I think is very interesting. So I would like to include a really excellent quote that he wrote about machinery and machines in general. And a lot of this, too, he talked about in his letters regarding Sauron and orcs and machines and these other things. But I really like this one. I feel it's very timely. And again, now this one he wrote to his son Christopher. A lot of his letters were written to Christopher Tolkien because Christopher was deployed during World War II. So he often shared a lot of personal wartime experience with his son, and I think he really wanted to boost his morale and boost his spirits, which is difficult to do, obviously. So I would like to share this quote with you. "I have just heard the news. Russians 60 miles from Berlin. It does look as if something decisive might happen soon. The appalling destruction and misery of this war mount hourly. Destruction of what should be, indeed is, the commonwealth of Europe and the world, if mankind were not so besotted, wealth the loss of which will affect us all, victors or not. Yet people gloat to hear the endless lines, 40 miles long, of miserable refugees, women and children pouring west, dying on the way. There seems no bowels of mercy or compassion, no imagination left in this dark, diabolic hour. By which I do not mean that it may not all, in the present situation, mainly, not solely created by Germany, be necessary and inevitable. But why gloat? We were supposed to have reached a stage of civilization in which it might still be necessary to execute a criminal, but not to gloat, or to hang his wife and child by him while the orc crowd hooted. The destruction of Germany, be it 100 times merited, is one of the most appalling world catastrophes. Well, well, you and I can do nothing about it. And that should be a measure of the amount of guilt that can justly be assumed to attach to any member of a country who is not a member of its actual government. Well, the first war of the machines seems to be drawing to its final inconclusive chapter, leaving, alas, everyone the poorer, many bereaved or maimed, and millions dead, and only one thing triumphant. The machines. As the servants of the machines are becoming a privileged class, the machines are going to be enormously more powerful. What is their next move?" That is a very prescient quote, I think, given the news cycle of recent. And I would also like to share one other little bit of a shorter quote, again, about machines, but I think it is excellent. In the way it, again, I think relates to current events. "But it is the aeroplane of war that is the real villain, and nothing can really amend my grief that you, my best beloved, have any connection with it. My sentiments are more or less those that Frodo would have had if he discovered some hobbits learning to ride Nazgul birds for the liberation of the Shire. Though in this case, as I know nothing about British or American imperialism in the Far East that does not fill me with regret and disgust, I am afraid I am not even supported by a glimmer of patriotism in this remaining war. I would not subscribe a penny to it, let alone a son, were I a free man. It can only benefit America or Russia, and probably the latter. But at least the Americo-Russian war won't break out for a year yet." This is all very depressing, I think, in its own way. But the good news is that we are leading towards something better. And in fact, this next slide is, again, I apologize, this is a little quote heavy in this part of the lecture, but we're moving on. There's one other aspect of Tolkien's writing, not just these descriptions and not just this thought process that was happening in his letters. There's one other aspect in The Lord of the Rings in particular where Tolkien included a little bit of himself, and it was a surprise to him when he discovered it, because he did not plan for this character to show up, and that is the character of Faramir. Tolkien did not plan for Faramir to suddenly appear the way he did. As he says in his letters, "I met him walking in the woods of Ithilien." He did not realize that Faramir was going to exist. But ultimately, Tolkien identified most closely with the character of Faramir, and to that end, he gave Faramir a couple of different aspects. The first is the dream of a great wave. Now, this goes back to the Silmarillion in the Akalabeth when Numenor is destroyed by a gigantic wave. But at this time in The Lord of the Rings, of course, that's not really going to be talked about. Now, Faramir has this dream about a wave. But also, Faramir in the books, now I'm not talking about the films, keep in mind, but in the books, Faramir's not really interested in war. He's interested more in reading and in lore and other things. He's not interested in being part of battle. And he stands on the brink of course, what is going to be the end of the Third Age, and he doesn't know how that's going to end. And this is leading toward an idea that Tolkien is going to have, and so I want to share this passage that is actually from The Return of the King. And this is about Faramir and Eowyn, and it's taken from The Steward and the King from that chapter. And as they stood so, their hands met and clasped, though they did not know it. And still they waited, for they knew not what. Then presently it seemed to them that above the ridges of the distant mountains another vast mountain of darkness rose, towering up like a wave that should engulf the world. And about it lightnings flickered, and then a tremor ran through the earth, and they felt the walls of the city quiver. A sound like a sigh went up from all the lands about them, and their hearts beat suddenly again. "It reminds me of Numenor," said Faramir, and wondered to hear himself speak. "Of Numenor?" said Eowyn. "Yes," said Faramir, "of the land of Westernness that foundered, and of the great wave climbing over the green lands and above the hills and coming on, darkness inescapable. I often dream of it." "Then you think that the darkness is coming?" said Eowyn. "Darkness inescapable?" And suddenly she drew close to him. "No," said Faramir, looking into her face. "It was but a picture in the mind. I do not know what is happening. The reason of my waking mind tells me that great evil has befallen, and we stand at the end of days. But my heart says nay, and all my limbs are light, and a hope and joy are come to me that no reason can deny. Eowyn, Eowyn, White Lady of Rohan, in this hour I do not believe that any darkness will endure." And it is in this time that Tolkien is going to start to realize that he believes in something different. That even though he has survived two world wars, and then he's watching these terrible things happen, things like the atomic bomb being dropped for the first time, that he believes that at the end of all of this, something good's going to come out of it. And that phrase that he coins is eucatastrophe. And he writes about this. Initially in an essay that he writes in 1939 called On Fairy Stories. And then he's going to discuss it in a letter that he writes to Christopher Tolkien. "And all of a sudden I realized what it was, the very thing that I have been trying to write about and explain in that fairy story essay that I so much wish you had read that I think I shall send it to you. For it I coined the word eucatastrophe, the sudden happy turn in a story which pierces you with a joy that brings tears, which I argue it is the highest function of fairy stories to produce." And so, of course, the most famous eucatastrophe that Tolkien is going to write is probably The Lord of the Rings. At the end, right, when the battle is happening in front of the Moran and it seems like all hope is lost, and then Frodo has taken the ring, and instead, what happens? The ring ends up being thrown into the fire, right? And then they win the battle, and everything is okay. Even though it seemed like the entire world was about to come crashing down, it seemed like the Third Age would be ended with the rule of Sauron. But instead it is not. It is ended with the rule of Elessar, Aragorn, right? And even today, we can see eucatastrophe all over the place, even though it's easy to turn on the news and think that nothing good happened today. I think it's very easy to feel that way. But even now, this is the psalm today. This is the psalm. That's a memorial path. This is all a memorial path that's been put into a trench. And people can go and visit this. And of course, as you all know, underneath the bridge that is out here in the museum is poppies, right? The poppies that grow in the fields now. That there has been, despite the senseless and horrific death, that something wonderful has happened, that things have changed and become better. And so I would like to sort of wrap up this lecture with one final quote from J.R.R. Tolkien. And it's from a letter that he wrote to his son. And he wrote it on May 4th, 1944. It was very close to the end of the war, but not quite over yet. And he wanted to boost his son's morale, as I mentioned earlier. And I really look to this quote a lot whenever things get me down. I really like to think about this quote. "But all big things planned in a big way feel like that to the toad under the harrow, though on a general view they do function and do their job, an ultimately evil job. For we are attempting to conquer Sauron with the ring, and we shall, it seems, succeed. But the penalty is, as you will know, to breed new Saurons and slowly turn men and elves into orcs. Not that in real life things are as clear-cut as in a story, and we started out with a great many orcs on our side. Well, there you are, a hobbit amongst the Uruk-hai. Keep up your hobbitry and heart, and think that all stories feel like that when you are in them. You are inside a very great story." And in closing, I just want to say to you all, or maybe I would like to challenge you, to find a way to go out, whether that's today or tomorrow, and work toward creating your own eucatastrophe. Find a way to bring more positivity and to keep up hobbitry in your heart. Thank you.
Thank you, Robbie. Folks, if you'd like to come down to either mic or I'm happy to come to you, just raise your hand.
Hello. Can the questions be over things that weren't in the lecture?
Sure. Why not?
What do you think was, since from such a young age, you know, writing so much, what do you think is lifelong Tolkien's biggest inspiration to write and create, personally or otherwise?
That's a great question, and I would definitely say the sagas were a major inspiration for him. If you're not familiar with the Finnish Kalevala, Tolkien translated a portion of that. A lot of his work was actually based on translation. He did a lot of that. For example, he translated Sir Orfeo, Pearl, and Sir Gawain and the Green Knight. So he really loved translation, and I think that a lot of that started because at an early age he was reading in other languages and becoming very interested in that, and also the function that that mythology played culturally for people. And like, so for example, what is the function of the Kalevala for the Finnish people at that time? And of course it's a noble oral story tradition, but I think in his own way he wanted to be a part of that.
Yes, in the books it said that, like especially the Silmarillion, what I got out of it, I saw a lot of like Catholicism from there. But he said that he was pretty much talking about like machines and the fight of modern day technology. Can you elaborate that?
Sure. Yeah, I don't know how many of you here have read The Silmarillion. I know that The Silmarillion can be very overwhelming, even when people hear about it, because it's famous for being hard, which I think is kind of funny. That's a great question. Tolkien talked a lot about machines or machinery, and how in The Silmarillion, the main antagonist of the book is named Morgoth. And so if you think Sauron is bad, I got news for you. Morgoth is a lot worse, and Morgoth is really the one who commanded Sauron. And Morgoth was also very interested in creation. Now the thing is that in the Silmarillion, the only god who can create is Iluvatar, who is the god of the book. Morgoth wants to be able to create, but he can't really do it. So instead what he's doing is perverting and making things horrible. He's twisting elves and men and finding ways to corrupt them. And another thing that he does too is he also is interested in creating things like using machines, so even like machines of warfare, so that would be things like, you know, catapults or great devices. Some of this is kind of not really too explicit in the book, but he's also digging a lot of pits, and then of course he creates the Balrogs. He's really like perverting the spirits, the Maiar spirits, to create Balrogs. But Morgoth, and then also of course we have Saruman, and then Sauron use machines quite a bit, and that becomes a major force in Tolkien's work, is that machines are not good in any way. And in fact, Tolkien was always leery personally about machines. He didn't like having a car. He had a car and immediately crashed it. It's actually a very, very funny story, and you should read it. He hated it. Then he also was very leery of recorders. He did a recording of Riddles in the Dark from The Hobbit, and the very first thing he did was read a prayer into it because he thought it was evil. He really was very leery of machines, and that definitely came out through The Silmarillion, especially because you have to keep in mind, he started The Silmarillion in the Trench in 1916. It's never going to be published in his lifetime. He's going to keep working on it all the way up into the 70s, and it's never going to be published. So I think also his feeling about machines only continued to get more antagonistic toward them. He never, ever liked them. So, yeah.
Yes, how do you think Catholicism influenced him and his suffering in life and also permeated his works, and how do you think that comes out in his works?
Oh boy, how much time do we have? Okay, all right. Great question. And yeah, I didn't want to get too much into the Catholicism today, but of course, does anyone know who the other author was that was in the Psalm, other famous author? Yes, C.S. Lewis. C.S. Lewis was also in the Psalm. And yeah, his Catholicism, Tolkien's Catholicism is so incredibly important to him. It's just a shame I didn't have any time to cover it today. But when Tolkien was a child, his mother converted to Catholicism and was actually cut out of her family because she converted to Catholicism. Okay, so keep in mind, it's the 1890s, early 1900s, and she had two young boys, she was widowed, and she was completely cut off from the family, which Tolkien never forgot. He never forgot how hard his mother worked and what all she did to provide for them and to help get them into school, and to the best schools that she could afford, which was not a lot, but this was why she pushed them to do well in school. You have to. I don't have money. You must earn scholarships and do better. And so when she passes away, when Tolkien is 12, and she dies from diabetes type 1, which you might think is a little odd. Insulin will not be invented for another 20 years. So she goes into a diabetic coma and dies within weeks. She's gone. And guess what? None of her family showed up to take care of the two little boys, you know, which is incredibly tragic. And so luckily they were put under a guardianship with Father Francis Xavier Morgan, who is the priest of his parish at the time. So Catholicism in many ways was a great, a eucatastrophe in its own way for him in his early life. So religion is going to play a major function. Now that being said, if you read his letters, in his letters, he explicitly does say that the Silmarillion is not necessarily about Catholicism, but it is about God, which I know is an incredibly open-ended, we could talk about this for hours type of thing, but it's really more about eucatastrophe, and to him, the ultimate eucatastrophe was the resurrection of Jesus, actually. That to him was the greatest eucatastrophe. In terms of religion that is actually in the Lord of the Rings, there's basically none. There's basically no religion, because by the time we get to the Third Age, religion has really changed from where we're at in the Silmarillion. But religion still had an enormous influence, and I feel like I could talk about this for a really long time, so I'm going to go ahead and stop it there. But please do look to his letters also for more information on that.
Obvious in the Lord of the Rings who the good guys and the bad guys are, but at the beginning of World War I, a lot of different countries and leaders decided that the war was going to start. How do you think Tolkien felt about, for example, the Kaiser, Prime Minister of England, premier of France, who let all this get started almost over the one assassination of the Austrian prince. How do you think he felt about the leadership starting something that ended up killing millions? Where, like I said, in The Lord of the Rings, I think it's pretty clear who the good guys and bad guys are, but I think it would be hard to say that the people who started the war were truly evil, mm-hmm. as they show mm-hmm. up in The Lord of the Rings.
Yeah, that's a terrific question, thank you. So World War I, which I kind of refer to as the great 20th century dogpile, because that is kind of what happens. We have all these secret alliances, and then just everyone jumps on top of each other and declares war very, very quickly, of course, during the July crisis. For Tolkien, this is something, again, I did not include in the lecture, but he really hated bureaucracy. And if we have any vets here, the vets that I have talked to often decry bureaucracy and sort of the ridiculousness of the higher ups. This is also, again, another thing that's in his letters. He talks a lot about his superiors not really knowing what exactly they're doing, and that they make him do things that are completely opposite of how he would do them, and that it makes a lot of people in his rank mad and all this stuff, and it all has to do with bureaucracy. That being said, I don't recall in his letters him really discussing the leaders during World War I, but I do know that he talked a lot about how people in the higher-ups had no idea what was actually going on the ground level and really being disgusted with that. So I don't think that necessarily, I think you're right, he would not have called them evil, but I think he would have said these people have absolutely no idea what is actually happening in Europe, and instead they're just automatically triggering all these alliances without even looking at the grand scheme of things. So at least that would be my guess.
Folks, we have time for one more question, so if you'd like to come down, now is the time. I am also still very happy to come to you. Robbie will also be in our lobby after the end of our program, so if you think of any more, please ask her. So now let's give a round of applause for Robbie Park today. Thank you all so much for joining us here today at your National World War I Museum and Memorial, and we hope that you come back soon. Have a great afternoon. Thank you.